Hi, my name is Trainmaster 04, and in this video, I'll be reviewing probably the smallest locomotive I've ever reviewed on this channel, and it is the famous Strasburg number 89 from Lionel. So sit back, relax, and let's get right to it.
Union Pacific 4014, do you read me? Over.
Roger that. Union Pacific 4014, I copy that. Over.
Start up and stand by. Over.
Yes, sir. Start up and stand by.
Like always, let's start with the history. Strasburg Railroad number 89 is considered a mogul-type steam locomotive with a 260 wheel arrangement underneath the boiler. She was originally built in February of 1910 for the Grand Trunk Railway by the Canadian Locomotive Company in Kingston, Ontario, and wore the number 1009. She would later receive a new number in 1919 while on the GNT and to 911. In 1923, her road name would also be changed from the Grand Trunk to the Canadian National Railway when the Grand Trunk was merged into the CN. While on the CN, she would yet again receive yet another renumber, finally, in 1951 to number 89. 15 other of her siblings would also receive a renumber into this arrangement. 89 would still retain her number all the way through till her retirement in late 1958 when she was stored on a deadline of locomotives in Montreal. Though it seemed 89 would face the same fate of other steam locomotives and being sold off to scrap where she would meet an inevitable demise, she was bought in 1961 by a New England seafood magnate by the collector name of F. Nelson Blount and was moved to North Walpole, New Hampshire in the United States. Number 89 was later moved to the Boston and Maine North Walpole Roundhouse starting in 1965 and would begin operating on the Green Mountain Railroad across the Connecticut River to Bellows Falls, Vermont. 89 quickly became one of Blount's favorite locomotives and would often be found at the throttle until his death in 1967. By that time, 89 would again be sold off to the now-renowned Strasburg Railroad in July of 1972. However, she would not have an easy journey to her new home. While on her journey from Vermont to Pennsylvania, 89 found herself stranded in Penn Central's Buttonwood Yard when Hurricane Angie caused the Susquehanna River to flood so much of the area that the locomotive was entirely submerged. Thankfully, though, after several days for the waters to relieve from the area, the locomotive was found to be barely damaged at all. Eventually, in June of 1972, number 89 would make its first run in the following year on March 17, 1973. She was used along the railroad for major passenger services along the 2-mile line and was also ran with Pennsylvania Railroad 440 number 1223. However, her age soon started catching up with her in the early 1980s, and major repairs were done to her running gear and also to her boiler. It wouldn't be until November of 1988 that number 89 came back out of the shops triumphantly and returned back to normal service. In 1993, she would be met with yet another fellow steam locomotive, former Norfolk and Western 480 number 475, which has found some famous limelight lately, and would continue to work on the Strasburg Road all the way up into today. Her paint scheme has also seen many different variations. For instance, in the current rendition that you see right here on the model, this was what she appeared to be in the 1970s when she went to the Strasburg Railroad from Vermont. However, in October of 2003, number 89 was modified and repainted to its 1950s Canadian National appearance with the tilted monogram logo. This logo would continue throughout her life until in 2008 when the tender logo was relettered to read Strasburg Railroad as she appears to this day. If you would like to go and visit the Strasburg Railroad, you'll likely be pulled behind 89 to this day as she is an active steam locomotive on the roster and is a fan favorite for most photographers. With the history of the real 89 taken care of, let's go ahead and move on to the stats of the model. This model was last released in Lionel's 2022 Volume 2 catalog, and within it, Lionel offered a total of 6 different types of moguls. The first one obviously being the 1970s version of the Strasburg, the second being a 2000s version that you can see to this day with the Strasburg Railroad Herald, a Canadian National 89 as seen in 2008 or even as she worked on the Canadian National, and then three others non-Strasburg versions. The first one being a San Luis and Rio Grande number 1744, which is very handsome in my opinion, a Middletown and Hummelston number 91, and a Southern Pacific. These models started shipping out to dealers around April to May of 2023, and for the measurements, this locomotive has a combined length of 21 3/4 inches, making it a very favorable model for 031 layouts. Under the hood, the locomotive is powered by a small flywheeled motor with thankfully a re-engineered gearbox that no longer causes the locomotive to jerk, and is also equipped with a single fan-driven smoke unit located up front for the main smokestack. Now, if you want to fill the smoke unit with smoke fluid, you simply just pour it directly down the stack. For other electronic features, this locomotive is equipped with Lionel's Legacy Rail Sounds system, and is also equipped with actual Strasburg communications, which is fantastic for an actual Strasburg Railroad locomotive. Other features, this locomotive is also equipped with Lionel's Legacy Command System, which means you have six, yes, six different options to run this locomotive. The first being is using Lionel's soon up-and-coming Base 3 Command System. The second is using current Lionel Cab 2 Legacy Command System. Third, using Lionel's Cab 1 TMCC Command System. Use Lionel's Bluetooth Command System. Use Lionel's Universal Remote, or even use conventional mode with simply placing the locomotive on a loop of track and turning on your transformer. With the model stats taken care of, let's go ahead and for a deeper look and see all the wonderful details this model has to offer. Starting at the front of the locomotive, here you can see we have a boiler tube pilot which looks nicely detailed and is flanked by two molded in steps leading up to the upper platform. In the middle, you can see we have a separately applied coupler cup bar with a separately applied chain going down off the middle, and right in the center, a dummy O-scale coupler, which can be swapped out for a dummy O-gauge coupler, so you can go and double head the locomotive. Moving on up from the pilot, here in the center, you can see we have the boiler front itself with a molded in boiler hatch door and is domed with a oval Strasburg Railroad number board with the number 89 in the center. On either side of the boiler, here you can see we have the running boards beginning, which are nicely pinstriped in white and are also given two separately applied steps leading up to it. Other details include two stanchions going underneath the boiler, two separately applied marker lights, which do change colors when the locomotive is in operation. It can be turned on to green, white, or simply off. And finally, up top in the center, here you can see we have the smoke box mounted headlight, which it too comes on when the locomotive is in operation. Moving around to the engineer side of the locomotive, starting at the bottom, here you can see we have the pilot wheel, which is nicely white-walled, one of the first of six drivers on this locomotive, and the cylinder itself. In this case, it is the incorrect cylinder if you wanted to be technical with Strasburg number 89, but it still does look good on this small model. For other details, here you can see we have the two-bar crosshead, the Stevenson's valve gear, which unfortunately is inoperable, the continuation of the running board, which is also striped, similar to the driver's and pilot wheel, separately applied brake hosing, and also an air tank underneath the running board. And then up on the boiler, here you can see the smoke box is nicely painted in the correct gunmetal gray and is donned with the beginning of the handrails, separately molded in pipework leading out of the sand dome, more separately applied pipework going around the side of the boiler, and molded in rivet detailing. Moving over to the cab area of the locomotive, here you can see the last two drivers, which too are white-walled and has nice side rod linkage. Up top, here you can see the end of the running boards as well as the end of that pipework, a nicely detailed firebox tucked underneath the running boards, which is nicely painted in the correct silver gray and is also donned with a bunch of molded in rivet detailing. Up top here you can see the cab is also nicely detailed with molded in rivet detailing, a separately applied red painted window seal rest, the number 89 in the correct gold with pinstriping around it, two windows, one up front and one onto the side, which are also painted red with cab glazing inside. And then also, finally, on top, a separately applied grab iron over the two sets of windows. Looking inside the cab, here you can see we have a nicely detailed back head with various separately applied parts such as valves, gauges, and even a standalone Johnson bar, which you don't see very often. It is also nicely illuminated by an overhead cab light when the locomotive is in operation, is controlled by two hand-painted crew figures, one on either side, and it also shows its fiery furnace, in this case the firebox, peeking through a partially open firebox door. On out towards the outside of the cab, here you can see we have two separately applied grab irons on either side of the locomotive's cab, two windows with cab window glazing, molded in rivet detailing, and then finally at the bottom, the locomotive's drawbar. On top of the locomotive, starting from the right and working over to the left, here you can see we have the main smokestack. And as stated earlier, this locomotive is equipped with a fan-driven smoke unit. And in order to fill the smoke unit with smoke fluid, you just fill it directly down the stack. Moving over, here you can see we have a nice curved sand dome with four leads coming off of it. In the center, a nice brass bell, which I am quite glad Lionel went ahead and made it actual brass instead of some type of metal and then painted over to look like brass. Real brass polished like this really does sell the market. Right over next to the bell is the steam dome. In this case, nothing much, but does look good on the locomotive. Coming towards the cab, here you can see we have a separately applied dynamo, and right next to it, the safety valves and whistle. Like the bell, it too is actual polished brass and really does look good against the black metal and looks a whole lot better than the painted on brass. And finally, looking at the cab itself, there's not a lot of detail to be shown, minus molded in rivet detailing and a molded in hatch. Moving over to the fireman side locomotive, and as you can see, it is pretty much the same as compared to the engineer side, but there are a few little minute differences, such as the addition of separately applied pipework along the boiler, shortening of some pipework underneath the running board, as well as a shorter air compressor tank. And then speaking of air, here is also a separately applied air compressor, which is located towards the middle of the boiler and is shrouded by an interesting stair-step designed running board. With the locomotive taken care of, let's move over to the tender. Starting up front, here you can see we have the tender end of the infrared sensor drawbar and also two molded in steps leading up to the tender deck. Up at the tender deck itself, you can see it is primarily detailed with molded in doors leading up to the coal load itself. And speaking of coal, Lionel's also included a molded in coal feature spilling out through the doors. Moving over to the engineer side of the tender, starting at the bottom, here you can see we have a pair of nicely detailed four-wheel trucks with spring rigging in the middle and correct friction-bearing journal boxes on each set of the wheels. Moving on up, the panel of the tender is nicely painted in the same black color, striped in the same gold, has various molded and rivet detailing going up and down, and is heralded in the center with the 70s-styled Strasburg Railroad emblem in the center. At the back of the tender, here you can see down in the middle, we have the locomotive's electrocoupler, which can be thrown by using Lionel's legacy TeamCC or Bluetooth command control systems. It's flanked by a separately applied coupler cup bar and two separately applied steps leading up to the back deck. On the back panel itself, here you can see we have two separately applied grab irons on either side of the tender, and also on the back panel itself, a separately applied ladder leading up to the top deck, and also 89 and the coal and water capacities painted on in the center. Finally, on top of the tender, here you can see we have a moderately sized coal load, which is nearly overflowing with realistic coal glued in into the space. And in the back, here you can see we have a modest water tank deck with molded in rivet detailing surrounded by separately applied grab irons, has a backup light which comes on when the locomotive is put into reverse, and finally is equipped with a water hatch that opens up like so to reveal an old empty space, probably reminiscent to the old TeamCC days. With the locomotive and tender covered, let's go ahead and fire up this model and go over the sound system.
Turn one right, ma'am. Let's get an application for continuity test. Good application. Okay to release. Turn one right, ma'am. We have good set, good release, good continuity on timetable train number one. Over.
That's a roger. Good set, good release, good continuity on timetable train number one. Out.
First up, here are the five different pullable whistles. Next, here is the bell. Here is the steam blowdown sound. Here is the water and coal fill-up sounds. And finally, here is a sampling of the crew and tower comm chatter.
Engine to tower. We're all made up. Am I clear outbound? Over.
Please hold at your location. Out.
Switchless says we've got one off and three on at the head end.
Got a lot of tonnage today. Better butt you in some slack before we start out.
We're loaded up on the go rocks. Out. Engine to tower. We're all made up. Am I clear outbound? Over.
You're clear to proceed east. Out.
Alrighty, I got some cars hooked up behind the tender. We've been given the green signal, so let's go ahead and pull this train out of the yard.
Thank you.
That about wraps up this product review, but before you go, let me go ahead and answer the two questions that I normally ask around this time of the video, and they are, what is the original MSRP price for this model, and also what is my personal opinion on it? Well, to start off, the original MSRP price for one of these 260s is right at $800. That does not mean that there is a markup on the Strasburg version. That $800 gets you everything, the Southern Pacific and all of the Strasburgs. If you want to pick up one of these models, I would suggest checking out either the secondhand market, such as eBay or even trains.com, as I've seen a few of these already popping up on there, either brand new or just even secondhand. If not, you can also look up trainworld.com or even Charles Rope. Both of those companies typically have overstock locomotives available for purchase and may even get a better deal than off of the secondhand market. With the price taken care of, let's go ahead and move on to my personal opinion. Overall, I am quite pleased with how this model turned out. The white walls against the black background is stunning, and Lionel did a great job by adding a little hint of Strasburg into a miniature form. If you have a small layout like I do that has 036 curves, this is a great runner for that. It can go anywhere on 072 curves or even as small as 031, so you won't be limited to any type of curve radius and still even get the wonderful features such as all the great smoke, the sounds, and also the great looking engine itself. Overall, I'm glad Lionel went ahead and fixed the gearbox problems from the past and even updated it to where it runs even better. Overall, on the layout, it did wobble a little bit, which is to be expected since the motor is driven from the center drive wheel and also is a very small wheelbase. But overall, the locomotive performed flawlessly going up and down grades in the mountain section of my layout. If you want a Strasburg locomotive, get it now before they become very hard to find. That's about it for this video, but before you go, I just want to say thank you very much for clicking on this video and also watching it to the very end. It takes me a long time to produce these high quality videos for you all to enjoy, so I do greatly appreciate it. If you'd like to not miss any of my future videos, please go ahead and click on that subscribe button, because that will allow you to access all of my future videos and be notified when they come out. While you're at it, please also click on that like button, as that allows my channel to grow even further by allowing people to find my content and also allows me to know that you actually enjoy this type of content and want more. But anyway, my name is Trainmaster04, and I'll be seeing you next time.